Well, my CIA ad may not be about remote viewing. There is another kind of remote sensing. But whether or not that's it, I have no way of knowing. I did scan the CIA ad this person sent me, and it stands alone as an interesting ad, whether or not it refers to that kind of remote sensing. You've got to see it. If you've never seen a CIA recruitment ad, this is your opportunity to see it. They should send me a thank you letter. I'm sure I'm going to get lots of agents for them for putting this up on the website. But it's a real honest to God... maybe I'd better not mix God and the CIA. Honest to goodness, CIA recruitment ad. Once again, here is Richard C. Hoagland. You notice I left your C alone now.
That's nice.
Anyway, you
wanted to talk about the signals.
Yeah, I do. I really want to lay out what you think you know about...
Well, all right. As of Friday, we projected, based on only DOORS data and the Guernsey report, which showed that there was a difference, in signal strength and all that, we said, look, suppose this isn't coming from the star. Suppose it's so loud, so strong, because it's nearby, in the neighborhood. It's a probe. Back in the 1950s, an American astronomer named Ronald Bracewell at Stanford, who did a lot of very extraordinary astronomy. In fact, Bracewell is kind of the father of the CAT scan.
Yes.
He produced a mathematical technique for taking images and with computer making three-dimensional data slices. And he started it with astronomy and basically observations of the sun, and eventually the medical profession took it over, and that's why a lot of people are alive tonight, because of Ronald Bracewell. Well, many years ago, he was involved with Sagan and others in this whole concept of, you know, ETs calling us on the phone. And Bracewell, being a pretty neat guy, said, look, it seems silly to wait at home and to try to probe star systems with radio beams because it takes, you know, decades or centuries to get a return.
Right.
Return signal, an answer.
Right.
He said it would be better to send automated probes, robots. We'll do it, you know, in 100 years, 200 years, you know, just wait a while. This was back at the beginning of the space age, remember, before Sputnik. And he conceived of the idea of multiple thousands of robots being trundled out on launch pads and sent out into the galaxy by somebody out there or somebodies, going into orbit around candidate stars that had likely Earth-type planets, and just waiting, and waiting, and waiting, and waiting. And when the civilization developing, you know, from caves and fire and horse and buggies and steam engines and all that, eventually invented radio, a la Tesla and Marconi, this probe that had been hanging around in the star system in some kind of stable orbit, you know, would pick up the signals. It would wake up, and it would then send a message. It would place a phone call. In essence, a very loud and big and boisterous message to call attention to itself, and it would begin to move toward the planet.
Right.
That was Bracewell, mainstream as you can get. So I propose this, and none of these SETI guys say, hey, wait a minute. Hoagland is resurrected from the archives, one of our own. Maybe we should look at this. Instead, they all take a stick out and beat that poor signal to death because it's not fixed in frequency and it's not fixed on the sky. It's moving, boys and girls. It's not stuck at EQ Pegasi. It's not 22 light years distance. Whatever it is, it's close and it's moving and it's changing frequency. Now, a few little technical facts. Don't bore people here, but a few technical facts.
All right.
Everyone's saying, you know, in the mainstream, oh, it's just an interference from a satellite. When they say that, they don't mean one of the probes NASA sent out, you know, Pioneers or Voyagers, because you were very right at the top of the show. They're heading in the wrong direction, Art. They're going away from us.
Right.
Their signals would be redshifted.
Right, not blue shifted.
Their signal is blue shifted.
See, I do listen to what you say. I never knew what these things meant, but I absorbed enough to be able to say that.
Friends can disagree. At least agreeably disagree. So it can't be a distant probe. It's moving, you know, in the wrong direction and much too... I mean, look, Voyager leaving the solar system...
Coming toward us. It has a blue shift, and that means it's coming toward us, right?
Yeah, assuming, of course, that the frequency is 1420. That's the rest frequency, and the 1450 plus is an indication of the signal rising in frequency because it's headed toward us like a bat out of hell.
Dumb question, maybe. Would this, whatever it is, be too far away to be optically observed?
Oh, I mean, the physical size of this thing is, you know, what, 30 feet, 50 feet, 100 feet? You're not going to see an optical telescope.
Okay.
Now, if it was firing engines, you know, good old thrusters,
yes.
rockets.
Yes.
You know, Star Trek impulse engines.
Yes.
And not on warp drive.
Yes.
Then as it slows down, it would create a huge optical something, a cloud of something. If it was hot hydrogen, let's assume this thing is really, really primitive, has nuclear engines, all right, and is slowing down by firing retro rockets, nuclear engines, like Bessard proposed.
Mm-hmm.
Those would produce a cloud of hydrogen that would fluoresce, that would be brilliantly visible in a part of the spectrum you can't see from the ground, from ground-based telescopes. But you could see them if you're in space.
Okay.
They would produce a brilliant visible glow at about 1,200 angstroms. I love to say angstrom, okay? 1,200 angstroms, which is the Lyman Alpha line of hydrogen. Now, guess what? The shuttle is up there this week carrying John Glenn, right?
It certainly is.
It carries in the payload bay, sitting on the corner, on the side of the payload bay, a Hitchhiker extreme ultraviolet experiment with a little telescope, which can see Lyman Alpha ultraviolet radiation.
Yeah, and they put the satellite out for the period of time they're up there and then retrieve it.
Okay,
when
that's the Spartan. That's looking at the sun. This is a separate experiment that's clipped to the payload bay.
Oh.
That we're not really supposed to know about.
Really?
Yes. Now, wait a minute. You don't suppose that NASA's coordinating John Glenn's flight and all of this and is looking at this thing in the optical region? Because remember, even if this is all real, if we're looking at a probe decelerating, sending at 1450 plus, all right?
Yes.
That doesn't mean it's the only frequency it's broadcasting on. That may be just the beacon. Suppose there's information coded in the beacon, which the big boys have already decoded, telling them where to switch for I Love Lucy, or Star Trek, or the program, in other words, the X-Files, Interstellar X-Files, imagine, mm-hmm. Chris. In other words, if we're limited to the sparse data we currently have, and we're dealing with people like the folks in Australia who don't seem to understand a whopping wow signal when they see it, I mean, how much intelligence is going on here that's below the water level? In other words, can people be that damn dumb, or are we all being conned?
You know, I wish I knew. I wish I knew the answer to that.